It's on. Oh, there we are. Before I share the word that the Lord has given, let's just take time and settle and listen to a piece of music. And if you, we're not going to sing it, we're just going to listen. Didn't it? Peace. Peace, Christian community. Peace in our world. Inner peace. We think about this word peace so often. Peace in conflict or from conflict. Peace in Ukraine. Peace in our hearts. In a chaotic world, we hear so much of people seeking peace. And I wanted to, in our time of transition as a church, just to come to this place of speaking about peace. And this morning, I want to speak about when Jesus met with his disciples, his first appearance after his resurrection, when he came to the upper room. And I want to see how he acted and what he said. And not just that, well, the presence that he brought and the truth that he brought into their lives and this new voyage and new journey that the church was about to embark on, and the birth of a church because of Christ. And as we move forward as a church into the new journey, the new voyage, if you like, that God has for us, I want to encourage us to re-establish ourselves in the place where Christ is the center. That peace, as we're named, is there for a purpose. And God has established us with that name, not because we are ones who own that name, but for this group of people, that see, that is the thumbprint of God upon us. And there's three facts how Jesus deals with us. So when we read the story, and let's read the story. If you have your Bibles, John 20, I haven't put it up. John 20, verses 19 to 23. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." So, this is the evening of the Sunday that he rose from the dead. That morning, Jesus had appeared to Mary Magdalene. And if you read in that same chapter from verses 1 to 18. And now he appears to all the disciples, or the 11 apostles, at once. Notice three things. The doors are locked. The disciples are frightened. And Jesus comes to them and stands in their midst. And those three facts tells us three things we can know about how Jesus deals with us today. Hang on. Technology today is great, isn't it? There we are. He says, "Peace be with you." The doors were locked. They were shut in the room. Jesus didn't have to knock to ask them to open the door. He didn't even have to open the door himself. He simply was there. He wasn't a ghost, for verse 20 says, he showed them his hands and his side. In another place, he said, "Touch me and see, for the spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." That's in the Gospel of Luke. So he has a physical body, but not exactly like ours, the same, yet different. He was simply there in spite of the closed doors. Which means that today in your life, Jesus can go where no one else can go. He can go where no counselor can go. He can go where no doctor can go. He can go where no lover can go. He can reach you and reach into you anytime, anywhere. There's no place where you are and no depths of personhood that you are which Jesus can't penetrate. For Jesus' resurrection from the dead fits him to do what no one else can do. There is no one else like him in the entire universe. What he is capable of doing in you, you cannot imagine. Think about all the complex layers of your life, which neither you or anyone else can understand. They're all familiar territory to him. Wow. Have you ever thought about that? That Jesus can go to anywhere he wants to go. Not only that, in the midst of their being locked in a room, they were afraid. For verse 19 says, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Their leader had just been crucified. He'd gone. They were left alone. They'd learned to trust him. They'd learned to rely on him. They'd learned to see him. And now he was gone. And their fear is totally understandable. If I was in their shoes, I'd be absolutely petrified. Because the threats were real. The physical threats were real. And the emotional threats that were on their lives were there as well. And into that fear, Jesus comes. Fear is something that we all struggle with from time to time in various ways, isn't it? And if we don't admit to that, we're probably lying to ourselves. What Jesus is saying in this action, I'm just going to get myself organized, is this. I come to my own when they are afraid. I don't wait for them to get their act together. I don't wait for them to have enough faith to overcome fear. I come to help them have enough faith to overcome the fear. The risen, living Jesus is still doing that today. In the life of Peace Christian Community, when we're looking to the future and it's a bit blurry and it's a bit foggy and we wonder, God, what is it that you're doing with us? Jesus is there and he comes to us in our uncertainty and he visits with us in our questioning and he says, peace be with you. He comes when we cry out to him in our own personal fears and he helps us. How many times have we cried out, Jesus, please help me? And he's come near with the promise, fear not. I am with you. Do not be dismayed. I am your God. I will help you. And that comes as a direct quote from Isaiah 41. He will do this for you if you receive him into your life for who he really is. Thirdly, Jesus comes to them and stands in their midst. The doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them. Verse 19 again. The point is that he came right into the middle of their meeting. He did not come to the edge and call out through the wall and deal with them as a distant God. No, he wasn't playing games with them. He wasn't toying with their faith. He wanted them to see him and know him and believe him and love him. He doesn't muck around with us and toy us like a marionette on the end of a string to sing the song as the music plays and make our mouths move and our arms from a distance. No, he comes and stands with us and is in the midst of us as his people. And as we transition as a church body, as a local expression of the wider church of Jesus, as a local expression of the hands and feet of Jesus in this community, He says, I am with you. My peace I leave with you. Isn't that exciting? That's what he wants for you. That's what he wants for us. He wants us to experience the living Jesus, to know him, to have him draw near into your life where no one else can go, to draw near into the community of faith so that he is shining through the community of faith, so that then he uses the community of faith to go into a community and speak that same message, peace be with you. And we'll explain what peace means in a minute. To have him help you in your fear the way no one else can help you. And have him come to you, close to you, not calling to you from a distance, but coming in the middle of you all together. So what does he say? That's the way he's acted as the risen living Jesus Christ. But now what does he say? And what does he and what do we see is that in his first appearance to his disciples? And he says three things to them, which we will highlight. And these three things turn out to be the three gifts to us, the three gifts to his church, the three gifts to us as individuals, as his people: the gift of peace, the gift of power, and the gift of purpose. With him, God, others, ourselves, and the world, he brings peace. The opposite of peace is what? Conflict. The opposite of power is what? Weakness. And the opposite of purpose is aimlessness. Many, many lives are ruined by conflict and weakness and aimlessness. Jesus did not come into the world and die and rise again to ruin your life, but he came to save it, and he came to complete it. And he came to restore in us the creation so that we would be new creations. Restore that which he originally designed, he restores into us. And what we will see is that he saves us from ruining our lives by becoming himself our peace and our power and our purpose. And I'm praying that Jesus would do this for me. Jesus would do it for you, that he would make himself your peace, that he would make himself your power, and that he would make himself your purpose. Peace be with you. So what did he say? Two times. Why? Two times he said, peace be with you. We see it before Jesus says anything about power or purpose. He wants to establish peace. The order here is really, really important. The peace that Jesus gives is before any of our empowered actions or any of our purposeful deeds. We don't initiate peace with Jesus by our actions. He initiates peace with us first. He comes to us. We're in the room scared. But he comes to us. And the Apostle Paul explains it like this. That song that we heard was based on this, Ephesians 2. And it says, he, Jesus, is our peace, who has made us both one, Jew and Gentile, and reconciled us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. A peace is accomplished. I'm just remembering what I've got on these. I know. Peace is accomplished. The peace that Jesus offers the disciples is peace that he accomplished when he died for them on the cross. When he died for us on the cross, he accomplished this peace. That's why in verse 20 he says,
When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. I am the one who died. I am the one you abandoned. And I am the one who was pierced for your transgressions. And the reason I can offer you peace is because my blood, I have covered, or with my blood, I have covered all of your sins. If you trust me, they won't be held against you. The wrath of God is turned away. And that's what Paul meant when he said, Christ reconciled us both to God through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. All the hostility between God and us was absorbed on the cross. Here, look at my side, look at my hands. I made peace with these. Justice was satisfied with these. Peace between you and God and me was established with these. When peace comes into your life, he comes into your life. And he is the only one who can bring that peace into your life. Meditation. Exercises like that can bring a sense of the feeling of peace, but it doesn't bring the peace of Christ. It's Christ himself that brings the peace and establishes it. So how does he bring peace into your life? Peace between us and him. And that's the first and most obvious meaning, of course. He is standing there among them, offering himself as a friend and a helper, not a judge. He could have started criticizing them for abandoning. He could have started criticizing them for their fear. He could have criticized them for their doubt. He could have criticized them for a whole bunch of stuff, but he didn't come like that. He came as a friend and a helper, not a judge. He establishes peace between us and God. That's why God sent him, of course. So that God's justice and wrath could be satisfied another way besides eternal punishment. God makes peace with us by substituting his son's suffering for our penalty. Now he comes to us as a loving father because the bridge has been reestablished and he restores. There's peace between us and others who are in Christ. We look around our fellowship here today and we're a motley bunch, aren't we? We are. I'm sorry. Sorry, Jeff. We are a motley bunch. Why do we have peace with each other? Because of Christ. Because what he has done. Because he established peace in each of us. And he establishes peace amongst us. So what happens when peace is upset in church bodies? I think sometimes we start to look at ourselves and functions and brands and organisations more than we look at Jesus. Because there's no peace in an organisation. There's not peace in ourselves. If there was, we wouldn't need him. We need him. And so to be reconciled with God is to be reconciled to all who are reconciled to God. No hostility vertically or horizontally. No racism. No ethnocentrism. That's a big word. No classism. No sexism. There's neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's no male and female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. That comes from Galatians 3:28 if you're taking a note. And then he brings peace between us and our own souls. The New Testament letter to the Hebrews says, the blood of Christ will purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God. That's Hebrews 9, chapter 4, verse 14. How many people labor under the misery of a guilty conscience? How many people say, I cannot forgive myself? I've said that in my life. Have you? Peace with yourself doesn't mean that you start feeling past sins as desirable. Peace doesn't mean that past sins cease to be painful. It means they cease to be paralyzing. Remember that? Past sins still cause pain. But when we're in Christ, they're no longer paralyzing. Isn't that nice? The pain may not be taken away immediately, but the penalty is taken away immediately through Christ. You're totally forgiven. You're restored. You're new creation. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, new creation. And that makes it possible to heal and to move on with a hope-filled life. Oh, if I look at some of the things that have happened in my life, I could easily fall into this pit of despair and think, there's no hope. You're just hopeless. But I can keep moving. Why? Because Christ is my peace. Christ has made peace with my soul. And then he brings peace with the world. Yes, Jesus died. He did what needed to be done so that someday, in God's time, all evil will be cast into outer darkness and the entire new creation will be full of peace and righteousness. Of the increase of his government, Isaiah says, and of peace there will be no end, with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. Whilst we look forward to that, we now live in the peace of the restored creation. We now live in the realm and the reign of Christ. Peace with Jesus. Peace with God the Father. Peace with Christ. Peace with ourselves. Peace with the world. It was an amazing achievement. And I want to just share with you what this means. If you were a Jew, you'd greet me this morning, Shalom Aleichem. And I would respond with Aleichem Shalom, which means peace, my friend, peace. Is it that you just want them to have a feeling of peace? No, Shalom means much more than a feeling. Shalom speaks of fabric. And this is a piece of calico that I prepared earlier. It speaks of character, and when shalom, the fabric of our lives, is affected by sin, it doesn't look so good. The nature and the character of the fabric is broken, and it tears, and it doesn't do so well, and it frays at the edges, and that's the breaking of shalom. That's what it means. But when God comes to restore peace, he restores the fabric of shalom. Jesus comes, and the Greek word is the same, eugene, not one in the bottle. He comes to restore that fabric and reweaves our lives. And he brings strength, not holes. He reweaves the thousands of interlocking threads in our lives so that there is a strength within us, and it's not us, it's him. He becomes the one that reweaves our lives. He's the one that forgives our sin and reweaves the fabric of our life. And not only that, he causes us as his people to be his agents within our community to reweave shalom into our community. By the serving of the poor, by the feeding of the hungry, by helping people to be housed, by people finding meaning and purpose in their lives, by them finding Jesus so that the fabric of their life is reweaved into that strength and that restoration of creation. Isn't that a lovely illustration of what shalom means? The fabric of our lives. Now, how do you receive this peace? Everybody doesn't have it. It's a gift of God. We receive it, or we walk away from it. Or better to say, we receive Him. For He is the one who is the fabric of our lives. He is the one who is the restoration of creation in us. If you have the risen, living Jesus as your Saviour and Lord and treasure and friend, you have the peace that He gives, the peace that He is. Since we have been justified by faith, Romans 5 says, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. The fabric of our lives has been restored. We are new creation. Jesus offers you that. I offer you that on His behalf. It's free. I hope you receive it. I spent most of our time on the gift of peace because it's foundational. If we don't have peace with God, we will take all the other gifts and use them to try to make peace. And it never works. Peace is first. And it's free. Everything else is the effect of peace, not the cause of peace. It is fruit. Peace is the root. Although it is one of the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. It is one of the fruits, yet it is the root of our lives. Why? Because He is our peace. He is the root of our lives. So let me just point in closing to the power and purpose Jesus gives. Both are mentioned in verses 21 to 22. Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I am sending you," which is the purpose. And in verse 22, "And when He had said this, He breathed on them and said to them, 'Receive the Holy Spirit,'" who is the power. Jesus was going to pour out the Holy Spirit when He ascended to heaven in Acts 2, verse 33. And that happens about 7 weeks after His resurrection. And we read about it in the first chapter of Acts, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth." And the work of the Holy Spirit that Jesus gives is that He makes us able to do what we are simply not able to do on our own. He gives us power. So here in John 20, verse 22, Jesus performs a kind of acted out parable. He breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." He didn't say, "Receive Him at this very moment." He said, in effect, "Realize that my breath, my life, my word will be in the Holy Spirit." We've seen this before in John 14 when Jesus said, "I will not leave you as orphans, but I will come to you." Jesus has come to us. He sent us the Holy Spirit, His Spirit. He has breathed on us. This person, this power, is our only hope for accomplishing the purpose He has for us as peace Christian community. The only way that we can accomplish that which He has called us to do is by the power of the Holy Spirit. And He gives us that purpose in verse 21, at the end of verse 21. "And as the Father has sent me, so even I am sending you." I want you to live in the world as my representatives, my ambassadors. I want you to take my peace and take my power and glorify my Father the way I have. I want you to restore the fabric of shalom in the community where you live. And that is by being praying people. That is by being the giving people. That is by being amongst others. by helping to fulfill need, by helping to be in amongst others, not by living in a box we call the church, because this is not the church, we are the church. And by living as the church in the community, not by saying we belong to this brand. No, no, no. We belong to Jesus, for he is our peace. He is the one who has restored the fabric in our lives. And we just want to share with you the restoration. When we pray for people in the healing shed, it's not because they're coming to the healing shed and the healing shed becomes their saviour. No, it's Jesus who is their saviour, and he brings restoration of shalom in their lives. This person, this power, this one helps us to bring the purpose. And Jesus comes to us and gives us his peace with God. He gives us power to do the kinds of things that mere humans can't do, like defeating our own selfishness and loving other people, even when they're unlovable, and treasuring Christ above all and making him the highlight of our lives. And then with that peace and that power, he gives us the central purpose for existence. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. I am sending you to extend my peace and my light and my truth and my life. I am going to my Father, but I give you my Spirit. I am the power in you. So go and glorify me in the world. That's our great purpose. When I think about giving away all of those 500 Bibles to army cadets, I keep thinking, God, and I keep praying, God, cause those young cadets to read your word so that they will be transformed. Because I can't restore the fabric in their lives. I can be the agent to introduce them to that and to introduce Christ to them. Whether that's being an example by the way I live with them and help them, by the way I give them a scripture and some devotionals to read, by just standing with them in their time of pain, by having compassion on them when they're hurting. That's how we bring Christ into people's lives, and by helping to share with them when they want to know, and by praying with them when they want help. I am sending you to extend my peace and my light and my truth and my life. Jesus says to his disciples, if you forgive the sins of any, they will be forgiven them. If you withhold the forgiveness from any, it is withheld. What he means is this. When you tell people about what I have done, speaking my word, about my work and the power of the Spirit, I am the one speaking through you. So that if anyone believes your word, I forgive their sins. And if anyone does not believe your words, I don't forgive them. And since you are my voice and my truth, I speak of you forgiving them and you withholding forgiveness. Do you get it? Which simply means that right now, what you make of this message from this fallible, sinful human messenger will decide whether you are forgiven or not. As an ambassador of Christ, I urge you to be reconciled with God. Receive as a free gift his peace, his power, and his purpose in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'll pray and then you can say. Lord God, forgive us, please, for when we have received, we do not freely give. Forgive us, dear God, for sometimes hiding within the place we call the church, and keeping ourselves there and not sharing your love, your peace, your light, your life, your truth. by being in community and bringing shalom, the restoration of shalom in community as it has been restored in us. And so from this day, we ask that not only would you challenge us and rattle our cages, but dear God, you would present to us every opportunity, wherever we go, whatever we do, in whatever place, that there would be that time and that opportunity to speak life and to bring peace from you through us into others. Help us, oh God, and help us to know your peace. Help us to know that restored fabric of our lives is true and is present and is continuing. And we look forward to the day when it's complete. So I pray over Peace Christian Community that we, as we transition into a different journey, that you would grant to us that sense of your peace, that sense of your empowering, and that sense of your purpose, for we come and exist for you alone, that you might be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen.
I believe that we're on the precipice of an incredible awakening, like the church worldwide is on the precipice of that awakening. And it's like the church is a sleeping giant and there's dragons out there that need to be slain. But what I wanted to say is there's another meaning of shalom. And in the old pictograms of shalom, when they had pictures, they had a teeth for the first picture. They had a crook, a shepherd's crook, for the second picture. They had a peg for the third picture. And they had water for the fourth picture. And in the last few weeks, God's been talking to me about this, and I'm actually sharing with an apostolic center on the Sunshine Coast tomorrow, and we're praying into it. But what that actually means is the teeth means to destroy. The shepherd's crook means authority. The peg attaches, and the water in those pictograms meant chaos in those old ones. So that is that we are to do that peace. The word shalom means peace, and we know that, but it's also that it means to destroy the authority attached to chaos. And I believe, as that second part of what David's talking about, and we grasp, the Holy Spirit comes and gives the power. And the church, the worldwide church, is awakened so that we can push back the forces of some of these things, these, let's call them dragons, that we can step into that deeper part of shalom, which is that we as the body of Christ and the bride of Christ can, as we enter that peace, which is interesting that that's our name, Peace Christian Community, that as we enter that peace and that rest, that then we can destroy the authority attached to chaos that we see in the world. So I find that, just wanted to share that. Thanks, David.